Hello and welcome to a special edition of 1MD Live on this Sunday afternoon, as always. This week's agenda is diabetes and COVID-19. As you all know, yesterday was also World Diabetes Day. So for creating awareness related to diabetes and diabetes in the current pandemic, we have none other than Dr. Shashank Joshi with us. Dr. Joshi, thank you so much for joining us on a Diwali. Dr. Joshi, as you all know, he's the chairman of the IDF Southeast Asia. And Dr. Joshi, I would ask you first to give the breaking news as we always do every week, and then we will begin the session.
So good afternoon, everybody. I wish everybody a very happy Diwali, the festival of lights, the festival of wisdom, knowledge, and a happy new year for all the business community. I know that it has been an extraordinary year. Most people want to write off 2020 because it has been a year where we have got home isolated, home restricted, and home modulated. So it's something which is very unique and something which we know that cannot be seen in this particular perspective. It also happens that on the 14th of November in India, we celebrate Children's Day. But for the last 20 years, the discoverer of insulin, Sir Frederick Banting, it is his birthday. And we celebrate it as the World Diabetes Day on behalf of the International Diabetes Federation. We know that every 7 seconds on planet Earth, one diabetic dies. And that's a very, very serious and a sinister connotation. And that is why we need to recognize that we have to ensure that we are going to make people living with diabetes live longer. People living with diabetes live happier. People living with diabetes complication-free. So we have three mottos, which the International Diabetes Federation has a mission. First is to make people living with diabetes more empowered, happy, and live with a positive spirit. Particularly, they should take care of themselves, empower themselves, and do that in a modified way.
Dr. Joshi seems to have lost connection. We'll just wait for him to be back. So thank you again, everybody, for joining. And if you have any questions, please post them in the comments. We'll be taking all of the questions. Dilip Kondinya, we are taking your question as well. Dr. Joshi,
I think there was some technical glitch.
Yes.
So with technology, you know, nowadays I think we have got all overloaded. So International Diabetes Federation has this year devoted its theme for the year of diabetic nurse. We know that as much as there's a shortage of doctors across the world and shortage of specialist doctors across the world, most diabetes care in most developed nations across the world is done by the nurse. Nurse doubled up in United States as a practitioner. She prescribes insulin. She prescribes insulin technique. He or she will also ensure that they are able to learn technologies like monitoring glucose, like doing the continuous blood glucose monitoring, like using insulin pumps, and so on and so forth. So the idea this year is to focus on the nurse. You know, the World Health Organization also has focused this year on the nurse. I am very proud that this year has been devoted to the diabetic nurse. And in the International Diabetes Federation, they have got an IDF school for nurses. So all the member associations across the world who want to enroll for an IDF educational initiative and program, they can do a free IDF school online diploma if they are interested in this nursing. So this is something which can be done. We know diabetes education forms the key for diabetes dissemination. Now, we all know that diabetes is a huge problem, particularly in COVID times. We are on breaking news. So what were the breaking news this week in COVID? And then we'll move to diabetes again. The breaking news in COVID was the world is engulfed with winter, with pollution, with overcrowding and festivities. So if you look at, let us start local, then go local. So globally, in North America, in Europe, and probably rest of the world, because the temperatures are dropping down very rapidly, very, very quickly, we are seeing the second wave at its peak. And probably the feeling is that just like Spanish flu, which killed 1 crore Indians when Indian population was 22 crores, the second peak might be more lethal. But that statement cannot be made with a presumption. We need data to back it up. So this is the global news of it. The new drugs, well, there's fluoxamine, which is a new drug, which is being now looked at in the diabetes spectrum and the diabetes world. And that is something which we recognize, that this is something which we are sensitive to and mindful of. So having said that, that we will need newer and newer and newer drugs in COVID. We are not getting many of them. And we know that the Global Society for Critical Care Medicine has condemned the rampant use of remdesivir. In fact, they have clamped it down completely. Fluoxamine has got an RCT, which was published in the JAMA. That was the other news. And a lot of news has been published on the vaccine as well as on the immunity front. One of the breaking news was the Pfizer vaccine. It's an mRNA vaccine. It is at minus 70 degrees centigrade. It has to be stored. Probably it will be useful for the US population. They have just made an announcement in the business media and the business world, but they have not shared any of their data in public domain or in private domain or in any form of a publication. So as far as India is concerned, Pfizer is unlikely to be there available for Indians for the next 2 to 3 years. If at all it comes to India, it doesn't have the core capacity to probably be effective in the Indian populations, because they'll have to do a trial in the Indian populations. And probably Pfizer is very US centric. At best, beyond US, it will be centric towards North America, North Europe and Japan. Beyond that, I don't think these global multinationals predominantly have a focus which is India centric. As far as India is concerned, we'll still have to rely heavily on the vaccine front, on the Oxford AstraZeneca Serum Institute vaccine. That vaccine is in its phase 3 trials. We'll have to see the safety and immunogenicity of it. The Serum Institute announced that they will be ready with a couple of million doses for the vaccine, provided it passes the phase 3. Now, remember, it is like first standard, second standard, third standard. The vaccines have to pass through the school of safety and efficacy. And most of these vaccines now are between 8th to 10th standard. 10th standard being the goalpost to go to the safety and efficacy standards. So whether it is the Pfizer vaccine, whether it is the Russian vaccine Sputnik, whether it is the Bharat Biotech ICMR vaccine, or whether it is Zydus DNA vaccine, all these vaccines now are entering into the phase 3 clinical trials, which ideally should last for 2 years. But they will be all short track. They will look at interim results, and maybe 3 to 6 months, we might have some vaccine on the anvil. So treatment front, not pretty much exciting, pretty much still remains the same. Oxygen prone position, steroids, and supportive care and individualized care. That's far as COVID is concerned. And the other thing which we unveiled is, because this is the World Diabetes Week, we are anticipating, due to COVID, a tsunami of diabetes coming up. What do I mean by tsunami of diabetes? Just like there will be a tsunami of lung fibrosis in people who got COVID and got moderate to severe COVID, their lung is going to get restricted and they will have lung disease. Similar to that, people who get COVID, they get 4 types of diabetes. One is somebody who's already a diabetic and gets COVID, and they can get more severe COVID. They are more likely to die, and we need to save them at any cost. And many of these people who are taking 2 or 3 tablets or insulin, they need high doses of insulin. And if you give them steroid, they will need insulin for at least 3 to 6 months. So that is the first type. Diabetics getting more severe COVID, more complications from COVID. That is the first thing. A lot of pre-diabetics, which means they have borderline diabetes, their 3 months average sugar is around 5.8 to 6.5, they get diabetes. And when pre-diabetics get diabetes during COVID, their sugar also go up very high. And then they need insulin or tablets for some period of time. The third variant, which we are seeing in COVID, is there is no history of diabetes, no family history of diabetes. There is no even inch of diabetes. And patient gets admitted for COVID in the ward, and they do a random blood glucose, and that random blood glucose is about 200 or 300. that is called as COVID-induced diabetes. This COVID-induced diabetes has very high sugars of 300, 400, because we know that the ACE2 receptors reside in the pancreas. And therefore, what happens, the sugar goes up tremendously. And that is called as COVID diabetes. This COVID diabetes stays. We are learning more and more about it. We are describing our cohort of COVID diabetes, but we are going to expect that COVID diabetes. And the fourth type of diabetes which you get is a temporary diabetes which you get during COVID. They don't have history of diabetes. They don't have history of pre-diabetes. If you do that 3 months average sugar, it is below 6 or 6.5. And then when the COVID comes, the sugar goes up. COVID goes, the sugar goes away, like gestational diabetes. And that is called as stress hyperglycemia due to COVID. This can occur with any viral infection, where the sugar can go up and again come down. Now remember, COVID also has drugs which interfere with diabetes. For example, when you give, and we used to give, and some people still give hydroxychloroquine, the sugar can precipitously fall. And we also know that, a lot of COVID people get steroids. And when they get steroids, the sugar rapidly shoots up. So in COVID, you need to be contacted to your friendly neighborhood diabetes expert. And we need to ensure that we eat prudently. See, the main thing about diabetes treatment has been fundamentally lifestyle, lifestyle, and lifestyle. See, despite of so many advances in diabetes, as we enter the 100th year of discovery of insulin, we are seeing that diabetes live shorter than normal population. On an average, a diabetic's lifespan is 7 to 8 years less than normal human beings. And probably this is something which we need to change. Number two, every 7 seconds, we are losing one diabetic to a complication of diabetes. And diabetic affects everything. There is no organ in the body which is not affected, whether it is the physical health or the mental health. In fact, we have our Guru Anna joining us from Bangalore. And we wish Guru Anna a very, very, very happy Diwali. And Guru Anna is the mind expert. Now, if you ask me, one of the commonest places where diabetics go is they get anxiety, they get depression, they get mental health issues, they get, whether it's type 1 diabetes, whether it's type 2 diabetes, and they have very, very different types of emotional reactions, mental health issues, and so on and so forth, which I'm sure Dr. Shetty will discuss with us at length. Physically, they get a lot of complications. The main complications which are sinister, which kill, are the small vessel or large vessel complications. In our body, we have small little vessels called microvessels or large vessels. The small vessel complications have the three things. They can affect the eye and the retina of the eye. They can affect the kidney and they can affect the nerves. So it is called as the triopathy. Three things. Trishul. The trishul of chota vessel. Diabetes ka chota vessel ka trishul kya hai? Number one, that the eye or the retina is affected, which is the window. Number two, the kidney is affected. So there's blood pressure which goes up in the kidney and kidneys leak out proteins. And number three, there is the nerves where you get tingling numbness of the nerves or you get numb nerves. And when the nerves get numb and there's no blood supply to the legs, you get diabetic feet. And this diabetic feet, and if there's a wound, because they don't understand that they are numb, they get ulcers and then we have to cut that and it is called as amputation. The commonest cause of non-traumatic amputation on planet Earth is diabetes. So those are the small vessel complications. What are the large vessel complications? Hypertension, heart attack, brain attack, that is stroke, myocardial infarction, heart failure. These are peripheral vascular disease. And if a diabetic smokes, it is a very, very bad combination, or uses tobacco. So all these things are there. Diabetes also have an increased incidence of cancer. But beyond that, it affects every organ of body. You know that when you get diabetes, you often get fungal infections around your, the genital area. You get, the nails become very brittle. Okay, your skin becomes very dry. You feel very thirsty. Most diabetics are asymptomatic. Most diabetics don't know that they have diabetes. But sometimes they get excessive thirst, excessive hunger. And then, they are peeing too much. Okay, it's called as polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia. So too much of hunger, too much of thirst, and too much of urine being poured. And they suddenly lose weight.
Right.
And we can actually pick up diabetics in the population. If we are staying in India itself, we are a vulnerable group for diabetes. If you are having father or mother with diabetes, both, your chance of getting diabetes is 90%. If either father or mother has diabetes, your chance of getting diabetes is 70%. If one of your family members has diabetes, your chance of getting diabetes is 40%. And after that, you have to do only one more test. Take a simple measuring tape and measure your waist. If your waist circumference is more than 90 in a man, or waist circumference is more than 80 in a woman, then the chances of you having diabetes are almost 100%. So then after the age of 20, every year you should check for sugars. There are four types of diabetes. Type 1 diabetes, where the beta cells which make insulin are fully destroyed. Type 2 diabetes, where the insulin doesn't work on the cells. And insulin basically is like a coolie. It picks up the glucose from the cells and makes it enter every cell. And what happens there in type 2 diabetes, too much of insulin is made, because the insulin is like a key of a lock which opens the glucose gate to glucose to enter every cell. And that key is blocked. You know, type 3, right. The third type of diabetes is basically the diabetes where you get diabetes during pregnancy, called gestational diabetes, and disappears after pregnancy. Just like I described you COVID diabetes. And the fourth type of diabetes is all rare diabetes. Disease of the pancreas, cancer, hormonal conditions, and so on and so forth. So these are the types of diabetes. Diabetes is very, very, very preventable. Now that Professor Shetty has joined us, let us welcome him. Let us see what are his messages for all of us in COVID times. If there's any breaking news he would like to share with us, you would like to share with us. And Anirudh, you can take over.
Yeah. Dr. Shetty, are you able to see us fine?
Absolutely. Yes. I think Dr. Shashank was with us during the World Mental Health Day. So I said I should not desert him during the World Diabetes Day. So in spite of being in Mangalore in a very picturesque environment, you can see the coconut trees behind. And happy Diwali to each one of us. In Mangalore, it is very special. We have the sweet dish which is made up of haldi leaves and with jaggery, and you also make it in Maharashtra. Fantastic. And he gave a beautiful explanation. But remember one thing, I need to share a story about somebody who has got diabetes and depression and COVID, shared by Dr. Vani Kulali, a very close friend of mine who's working in the COVID hospital for much longer than others. This gentleman refused to get admitted to a private hospital, though he could afford one. He went into one of the cheapest government hospital. And when asked, he said, I have no money. I want to save my money. And when the doctor took his history, we found that he had enough money to be in the best five-star hospital. He was a businessman. And he just believed that he has no money. And when they interviewed him more, they found that he had delusions of poverty, which means that some people who are depressed have the symptom that they believe that they're poor in spite of they having money, and they do not want to spend that money in any form, even for their own health. There are patients who come to us very often, and the close relatives would say, we'll pay you here, don't tell him that we paid you. We have said that this is a free treatment, because he does not want to spend money. So one important symptom for depression, which you all need to identify, is a delusion of poverty, where the person believes that he has no money in spite of the fact that he has enough. But the belief is very strong. It's not intentional. It is not malingering. It is not being stingy. But it starts at a point of time. And if you pick the symptom up early, you will be able to treat that depression. And remember, depression also increases blood sugar. And those who are diabetic also have a higher chance of suffering from depression. Over to you, Shashank. What have you done today for Diwali?
So Diwali is a festival of lights. But we are in extraordinary times. And my commitment is to ensure that we are having a COVID-free Diwali and a diabetes-free Diwali. Now, both these things look utopian as ideas. But I think 10 years from now or 20 years from now, we probably will have a COVID-free Diwali. We can't predict. We are not astrologers. We are scientists. But this is a wish we can have. And we can have a complication-free diabetes. Both of them are sinister twins. As I told everybody before you joined, sir, every 7 seconds we lose one diabetic on planet Earth. Every year, 4 million people die due to diabetes. That's nowhere near what COVID has killed. Okay. Now, remember, diabetes is not competing with COVID. But most people don't even know it, that diabetes is there. And In 2003, the American Heart Association and American Diabetic Association made diabetes a heart attack risk equivalent. How many people know that minute you get diabetes, it is equal to a heart attack? Diagnosis of diabetes itself is a heart attack risk equivalent. When you get a heart attack, there are 20 relatives. Everybody wants to know whether I will die or not. But by just having that little sugar up in your body, okay, in your blood glucose, it is as bad as a heart attack. So people need to take diabetes seriously. And this year, we are empowering our nurses so that they can take care of our diabetics better.
Right.
This is one of the best times on planet Earth with diabetes because it's all digital. Mm-hmm. And diabetes care has become a lot digital. There are so many apps. There is so much of technology, whether it is monitoring blood glucose. There is so much of innovations in nutrition. There is so much of physical activity innovation. And we can actually reverse diabetes. Today, we have programs where you can actually think of reversing diabetes. And therefore, for that, you know, you need to have simple things of lifestyle. So if you are in Diwali, Dr. Shetty, and you are having diabetes, eat less. Tasting is important. It's very important to taste so that you don't spoil your taste buds. You must taste, but you should only taste and share your sweets. Don't have all the sweets to yourself. So eat less, but taste well. Okay. Eat on time. Eat the right food. Eat slowly. Okay. Do a lot of physical activity. Okay. Try to do a lot of Surya Namaskar, Uthak Baitha, build some muscle, you know, call up everybody, walk the talk. I love Dr. Shetty with all those beautiful coconut trees. He's walking the talk. He's so physically active. He looks so fresh, exuberant. You know, generate positivity. Diabetics need to understand that they need to live happily with diabetes, but sensibly with diabetes. There are a lot of commonalities between COVID and diabetes. One is acute, one is chronic, but both of them need sensible behavior. They need a lot of common sense. They need a lot of decluttering and focus. So diabetes is all about lifestyle focus. So eat less, walk more, sleep well. Whether it's COVID or diabetes, sleep for a good 8 hours. But don't sleep too much. That's bad.
Right.
If they snore during sleep, get a sleep test done and get a CPAP machine put. Or lose some weight. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then be stress-free. Don't give stress. Don't take stress. And if you want to be happy with diabetes, want to have a lot of exuberance and positivity with diabetes, but if you still feel negative about it, if you feel emotionally down, then we have our Guru Anna, Dr. Shetty. Please contact him. Even if he's in Mangalore, he's virtually connected. See, there are advantages in COVID now. With COVIDization of the world, as we call it, AC and BC, you know, before COVID and after COVID. In before COVID, if Guru Anna was there, he would not be connected. He would be on his own with his coconut trees, enjoying with his mother and sister, you know, Diwali. While in the COVIDized world, we have hooked him on virtually to tell the planet Earth how to behave well, how to behave sensibly, how to be happy, and how to give that exuberant smile which he gives to make people put at ease. Diabetes need to be told, not to be stigmatized. So therefore, we don't call them diabetics anymore. We call them people living with diabetes. And we want to empower them. We want to make them diabetes care specialists. See, in 2011, India lost its first rank to China. That time, I was president of the National Diabetes Society called RSSDI, Research Society for Study of Diabetes in India. And that time, my mission was that India should be the diabetes care capital of the world. We should not be the diabetes capital of the world. We are no more the diabetes capital of the world. India, China has already taken the first rank. Unfortunately, we are trying to compete with United States for to be the global capital of COVID. Fortunately, we have lost that war. And in Mumbai and Maharashtra, we can see a lot of cases have come down. But in North India, there is an explosion of the second wave. But we should not be stupid because we are again behaving inappropriately. In COVID times, it's all about lifestyle, lifestyle and lifestyle. And in COVID, you need a little more correction because you need to do a little masking, you need to do a little distancing, and you need to, of course, do a lot of sanitization. So I think the hygiene part is COVID and the lifestyle part is diabetes. And both these diseases can be managed well. Remember, if you have diabetes, you are more vulnerable to get COVID. That doesn't make you depressed. Okay. And there is a triple in this twin epidemic, which is called as hypertension or heart disease. Often hypertension, heart disease, diabetes, and senior citizens above 50, 60 have this combination. Do you mean to say that they should just feel negative about it? No. Be cheerful, be positive, behave sensibly. You are more at risk, so you need to be more appropriate on your behavior. That's all we need to do. So I think that focus, that motivation, that devotion is something which we need to recognize and do it in a much, much better way.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Joshi. Actually, before we go to Dr. Shetty, I'm just going to quickly ask you one question from Dr. Goyal. He's asking, is it wise for all diabetics to take one tab of HCQS daily in normal cardiac status?
So as an anti-diabetic medication, Dr. Virendra Goyal, who is from Rajasthan, who's a senior physician, active member of our Association of Physicians of India, is asking this question. Hydroxychloroquine in India has been approved as a rheumatological drug as well as a drug for type 2 diabetes. And since 2014, we have used it as an anti-diabetic agent, as an adjuvant drug, means as an add-on drug. So under medical supervision, a lot of people take HCQS. And I have found it, and I have done research on it, which I published, where diabetics get frozen shoulder. Now, there I have given the HCQS as a drug for diabetes and for frozen shoulder. It has done very well. Like rheumatologists. See, people with rheumatological conditions like lupus, systemic lupus erythematosus, or all these rheumatological diseases, we use HCQS. In diabetes, we use it as a drug. Just like metformin, diabetes is on our formulary in India, approved by the Drug Control Journal of India as an adjuvant. But you have to be careful for hypoglycemia. But that, whether they get less COVID, we don't know. That's how hydroxychloroquine from China, they observed that people who were in the rheumatology clinics, who were being treated for SLE, they never got COVID in China. That's why they thought that probably hydroxychloroquine worked. And then, of course, a French study came out. But now we know that most of the trials done in moderate or severe COVID for HCQS has not held true. In mild disease, maybe it may have a role with azithromycin. If the heart status is normal, and if you take it with a little bit of zinc, which opens the pores, and your QT interval is normal, and you are below 50, probably it might have a role.
Thank you so much, Dr. Joshi. Dr. Shetty, hello. You're on mute, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Just a quick question before you go ahead with your second story. One is from the preventive angle. Yesterday, somebody asked in a session is there some sort of exercises for your mental health that you can do, which can help you in eating less? Because we keep speaking about eating less and physically controlling yourself. But the whole thing is that how do you control your mind when you get the cravings, etc.? So if you can throw some light on that and also tell us a unique story. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I think what is very important for us to understand, which Dr. Shashank also said, is stress induces craving and eating. The hormones, there are two hormones, one for appetite stimulation, other for appetite suppressant. The appetite suppressant hormone is subdued and you start eating at night, you start raiding the fridge, etc., etc. Stress causes increased eating. Now exercise can manage your stress. Exercise resets the hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal system. In that way, you may not enter into binge eating. That's number one. Number two, if there are people who are prone to binge eating, they need behavioral therapies, which are very important. One behavioral therapy is exposure and response prevention, which means I keep a kg of kaju katri in front of his eyes, and I ask him to watch it, ask him to go through the sensations, thoughts, and the feelings which he undergoes, and after some time he slowly calms down, and he will not pick up that piece of kaju katri even if it is there. Exposure and response prevention is also good in alcohol. When people drink a lot of alcohol, keep a bottle of alcohol and a glass and an ice, and see that they don't respond to the cravings which come. That is one way. The second is for binge eating. There are some people who are diabetic and also have impulse control and a mood issue which may not be diagnosable depression. They do very well with certain medications of antidepressants. I don't want to name them because I don't want people to go and buy it. The third most important thing is that lifestyle habits of the family. There are certain families who go on eating all the time. I mean, they love eating all the time. Hame khana bahut achha lagta hai. Hamare yahan sab log khate hain. And they are broader chairs. They are bigger chairs because they need bigger and broader chairs. So this sort of a family behavior also needs to be controlled. Fourth is reckless behavior, which borders to hedonistic behavior. Kal kya hoga, kisko pata, aaj zindagi ka le lo maza. There you need to have a shift in the mind here. And sometimes these guys don't do well with doctors. They do well when they have a heart attack, when they fall unconscious on the road, but some do very well with their own gurujis, with their priests, who tell them, take an oath that from now on you will not do that. So there are many, many variants. Coming to the second important aspect of depression, one was, as I said, when somebody has delusion of poverty. The second is, I still remember this man, depressed, on treatment. He suddenly started touching people's feet in the family. I troubled you a lot. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. Please, please, please forgive me. People were very happy because they felt that this guy has changed. His attitude in life has changed. He's become a better human being. And this excessive need to be forgiven is also a very dangerous symptom of depression. A lot of people, after seeking forgiveness and assurance from the close members of the family and the relatives, would harm themselves, would indulge in self-harm behavior. So when anybody in your family suddenly starts saying, please forgive me, goes and meets a lot of people and says, I did something wrong to you 5 years ago, and everybody feels such a nice man, is now asking for forgiveness. So asking for forgiveness consistently, irrationally, and suddenly is a very dangerous symptom of depression. You need to be very careful and you need to take help immediately. Over to Dr. Shashank, your day. Dr. Shashank, World Diabetes Day.
Dr. Joshi?
Yeah, so, you know, let us move on. If there are any questions related to diabetes and COVID, we'll be happy to answer from the viewers. We can take some rapid fire questions, one or two, if we have related to COVID also. Yes. Beyond that, as I said, this year's theme is lifestyle, lifestyle, and lifestyle. And adherence to lifestyle is where Dr. Shetty and mental health professionals come in a very big way. We need to understand that diabetes is a very serious disorder. People take it very lightly. A lot of people think that they can't, you know, there are a lot of negatives about diabetes. You say, don't eat sweets, don't do this, don't do that. Whenever we, diabetes you get because of inappropriate lifestyle. And to correct that, we want a quick fix pill. So remember that diabetes is not about just taking a tablet and eating what you like. Okay, that's not as simple as it. So diabetes has a simple ABCDEF formula if you want to live happily with diabetes. So if you get diabetes, don't get disheartened. But the A stands for A1C, the 3-month average sugar. Okay. If your 3-month average sugar is below 6.5 or 7, you are good. Whether you take tablets, whether you take insulin, you are very good. Then, of course, the second is B, blood pressure. Try to keep your blood pressure below 130 over 80. C is for cholesterol. Try to keep the LDL cholesterol below 70 or 50. And sometimes you have to take a statin drug for that. It saves you from a heart attack. Okay. D is for diet. Eat less, eat slowly, eat on time, eat the right food, avoid sweets, fried food, fast food, and dry fruits if possible. Okay. And if you eat any of these, taste it, spread it, share it. And if you can't, and if you still have overindulged by mistake, just do a lot of physical activity. E stands for exercise, E stands for eye. The C also stands for getting a cardiac checkup and eye checkup done every year. And F stands for feet. So if you do all these simple ABCDEF formula, a diabetic can actually have a normal life. And I've had patients who have lived their life, even with type 1 diabetes. Now remember, type 1 diabetes is different from type 2 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, you need lifestyle, 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 tablets, 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 supervision, supervision, supervision with monitoring and complication-free time. While type 1 diabetes, you need insulin for life. With understanding the equation between insulin, the carb, the calorie we eat, and the physical activity. So we need to get that grid sorted out. Whether you use technology, whether you use common sense, do that. If you do that, then we can do very well. So Anirudh, any rapid fire questions we can see?
Yes. One question is BCG vaccine beneficial for diabetic patients in COVID-19?
See, BCG is a non-specific immunogen. So if you are, if you take BCG, it's not going to hurt you, but it's not going to help you. We don't have data in diabetics because diabetics, in short, are immunocompromised. So if you're already BCG vaccinated, by taking a second shot of BCG, we don't have data to show that it's a useful vaccine. But every diabetic should take a flu shot every year. And also every diabetic we recommend should take a pneumococcal vaccine if required. Because we can prevent a lot of their secondary infections if they take pneumococcal vaccine above 50 as well as take a flu shot. So flu shot and a pneumonia shot is important for a diabetic. Not really a BCG vaccine or a MMR vaccine. BCG is a non-specific immunogen. People who are cancer survivors sometimes take BCG as a cancer immunoadjuvant. But data on BCG is very weak in elderly population for COVID also. So it's not a standard of care. So don't get carried away by that. Rather than that, build good some good immunity.
Shashank, you another question. Autoimmunity and diabetes. Raj Yalgi.
I was just about to ask.
Raj Yalgi is a physician. He's doing his MD medicine now.
So he has asked two questions. Which type is latent autoimmune diabetes and ketosis prone diabetes fall under? So type 1 diabetes is autoimmune, where the beta cells of the pancreas are destroyed. Type 2 diabetes is insulin resistance. There is an entity called LADA or type 1.5 diabetes. And there is a type 3 diabetes. So let me explain that and then I'll explain his ketosis protocol. So the type 1.5 diabetes is called LADA, L-A-D-A. Latent autoimmune disease of the adults. Means people about 30 or 40. Okay. You start them on tablets, but sugars are still 300, 500. Okay. Then we do a C-peptide, it's very low, antibodies are very high. So basically it behaves like type 1, but is in adults. So this is called as latent autoimmune disease of the adults, which many people have nicknamed as dead number diabetes. Ek number diabetes, pura life insulin. Dead number diabetes, pura life insulin. Do number diabetes is do numbri, yane lifestyle, yane appropriate your lifestyle. Okay, thoda khana peena, khana kam khao, bhago jada, okay, and tablet lo. Okay, then there is a diabetes which is ketosis prone.
Right.
What is this ketosis prone? Now, there were diabetes which was also in the good old days, we used to have a diabetes called Kerala diabetes and a diabetes called Orissa diabetes. Do you know what is that? It was formerly called, it's now a secondary diabetes. Okay. The Kerala diabetes was basically tropical pancreatitis. In Kerala, people who were malnourished, they used to have for their staple food a lot of cassava. And Professor Guy Varghese and Professor Pichumani did work in 1967 to show that this cassava, because there was no proteins, had to be detoxified in the liver by methionine and sulfur-containing amino acids. So if you don't have proteins in your body, there was no methionine or sulfur-containing amino acid to detoxify this cassava. And these cassava got plantation ka alkaloids got converted into cyanogenic alkaloids. They went and bombarded the pancreas like bullets. Wow. And they got fibrosis of the pancreas and calcification of the pancreas. So it was called as a tropical calcific pancreatitis or secondary diabetes. And there it was ketosis resistant. Okay. Because alpha and beta cells both were destroyed. And this diabetes needed insulin. So abdominal pain, malnourishment, malabsorption was Kerala diabetes or tropical pancreatitis. We have described it all over India now, but it's a rare form of diabetes. Second diabetes was protein energy deficient diabetes from Orissa. In Orissa, there's a lot of malnourishment. So late Professor B.B. Tripathi and his group described that the beta cells did not get any energy, any nutrition. So the beta cell mass remained very less, which make insulin. And they got so malnourished, just like I am very lean and thin. The beta cells and the pancreas of people there were very lean and thin. And therefore, they couldn't make adequate insulin. And they also needed it. So this is another form of diabetes, but now they are classified as secondary diabetes. So there was Orissa diabetes. Ketosis prone diabetes means you get ketosis again and again.
Understood.
Okay. And that is brittle diabetes. Often it needs insulin. Often they don't have beta cells or pancreas. And that is something which we recognize now. There is another diabetes. Interestingly, Dr. Shetty, we said ek number diabetes, dead number diabetes, do number diabetes, secondary diabetes. We have type 3 diabetes. This type 3 diabetes has no diabetes in it. It means you start forgetting things and you get Alzheimer's disease. Most people now believe now in the world that Alzheimer's disease is type 3 diabetes. It is insulin resistance of the brain. And there is research to show that they will give oral or nasal insulin to absorb and cure that Alzheimer's disease. So imagine one fine day, research is now ongoing. Of course, you don't take insulin because you have Alzheimer's and you're losing memory because you'll get low sugar attacks, remember. But there is research to show that type 3 diabetes is Alzheimer's disease. So you have all these acronyms in diabetes. Then we have these flat blush diabetes, which is diabetes comes suddenly and it explodes and you need insulin for life. Then we have a diabetes described from a lot of consanguineous families. You know, in lot of customs, they marry within the families. First generation, second generation. So that is called as monogenic diabetes. a lot of work has happened in ICMR Center of Genomics with Dr. Mohan and his group and many other parts called MODI. So we have Narendra Modi as our chief minister, Prime Minister of the country, but we have MODY, MODI, as a type of very rare diabetes called the M stands for maturity onset diabetes of the young. Maturity onset means type 2 diabetes of the young. It is monogenic diabetes. It has a lot of genetic defects. So there are almost 12 types of these diabetes where there's a single gene defect. Normally diabetes is polygenic. I told you, if your father, mother have diabetes, you will get diabetes. True. If your relatives have diabetes, you will get diabetes. That is polygenic, multiple genes. Monogenic means single gene defect. And you don't need insulin. Three successive generations. Age of, so normally there are Tattersall's criteria. Age of onset less than 25. You don't need insulin. Okay. It can respond to tablets very well. Okay. And three successive generations have diabetes. So grandfather got diabetes at 65. The father got diabetes at 40 and the son is getting diabetes at 20. So these are the three successive generation of diabetes. It's called as monogenic Modi type of diabetes. So diabetes are different types.
Okay.
Okay. But remember, the treatment is simple. Lifestyle is common for everybody. Monitoring is common for everybody. Okay. Only thing is, in type 1 diabetes, secondary diabetes, rare diabetes, you need insulin for life. While most of the other diabetes can be managed by tablets alone. And now we have excellent tablets, which can actually, they are master tablets, we call them. They can actually reduce the risk of getting kidney problems or heart problems. So they offer cardiorenal protection. These are like smart diuretics. They have, of course, all. Now remember one thing. Every medicine you use on planet Earth or whichever pathi will have effects and side effects. So it has to go through a safety protocol. It has to go through an outcome trial. So that is something which we recognize.
Okay. One more question from Dr. John Rodriguez, and then we'll go to Dr. Shetty for his last comment. Is complication in COVID higher in type 1 insulin dependent than type 2 diabetes? Dr. John Rodriguez is asking.
Not necessarily. In fact, initially when COVID started in month of February, March, people thought that below 30 years, type 1 diabetes are immune from COVID. But as data has emerged now from United Kingdom and Europe, they feel that both of them are equally vulnerable.
Okay.
Type 1 diabetics and type 2 diabetics are equally vulnerable. Type 1 diabetics might have a poorer outcome in some cohort studies. But we generally feel that the type 1 people are younger, while type 2 people are older. And the older population has a higher risk than younger population. That's something which we know better.
Okay. Last question from Dr. Goyal and then we'll close this. Dr. Shashank, what do you prefer out of two as profilizers in diabetics as you have been taking both ivermectin or HCQS?
So I would be very frank. Neither ivermectin nor hydroxychloroquine in prophylaxis have good, robust data. So data is clearly lacking. We need much better data. In a research mode, people are using ivermectin, but I do not recommend it as standard of care. Okay. Currently, the ICMR standard of care is hydroxychloroquine till they make a change. And till they generate data to show a change, I think neither works. I think COVID-appropriate behavior is far more effective than any of these medications. Ivermectin has shown some results, but the point is we don't know the dose, the frequency of administration, and we don't have an RCT to back it up. We at best, we'll have some case control studies or some cohort studies. Okay. Same problem with hydroxychloroquine. In prophylaxis, again, we don't have an RCT backing it up. We have it as case control or cohort studies where it might have shown some use. But hydroxychloroquine has got a lot of hype around it. But I think it has not stood the test of time. And there's also a growing school of thought that feels that it could have harmed the heart. But that I don't think is true because we use it as diabetologists, rheumatologists use it very regularly. And we don't see those type of QT prolongations in day-to-day care.
Correct, correct.
So that's something which we recognize quite often.
Dr. Shetty, your last comments and then Dr. Joshi's last comments.
I think that was a fascinating sharing on diabetes.
Yes.
Shashank, I know you for so many years, but I think thank God I'm there today. 1, 2, 3, 4 diabetes of the brain. I think each one of us should see this video not thrice, as Sudharaman says, but 10 times. Beautiful. I have never met an endocrinologist talking clearly with so much clarity, so much science, and so much evidence. It's so easy to understand, and it's news to me. Well, as I close, I would like to share a lifestyle experience of somebody who has diabetes. There was this once industry owner of a small scale industry. Everything closed down. He was borderline diabetic. He was doing exercise and yoga. As my friend Umesh Vakharia here, who has had COVID and is doing half an hour pranayama, walk in the garden, and his reports were all normal. Suddenly, when he had to pay 40 lakhs to his employees because they said they have to leave, and his borderline diabetes increased to a very great extent. He did not know what to do. He was seeing a diabetologist who was giving him many tablets but did not work. What worked here was helping him to understand that 40 lakhs today or tomorrow might come, might not come, but he needs to really shift his thinking. He needs to help himself understand that the worst case scenario is he may not be able to pay today, he may be able to pay sometime later. And when we brought down the anxiety, when we brought down the negative toxic emotions, and with this doctor who treated him for his diabetics, his sugar came under control. So what is very important to understand that stress can increase sugar among those who have borderline diabetics or even those who have none. The second case was a property dispute. And this gentleman was 45, had a very big dispute with all his brothers and sisters, 100 crore property locked in court. Everything was quiet when the courts were closed. And this man had no liquid cash to live. Remember, there are a lot of people in Bombay, across the country, across the world, who have been financially devastated. Their properties were closed, but they have no liquid cash. Suddenly, the case started, and all the sisters hired great lawyers to see to it that they would get their share of the property. It was around the time of COVID, just before COVID. Because of this intense stress that he could not afford a lawyer around just before COVID, and he could not be represented adequately in the courts, his diabetes increased. He had uncontrolled diabetes. Again, here, a psychologist, yoga, relaxation, and exercise helped him to control his sugar along with the tablets which his diabetologist gives. So the last message is, remember, you may not be able to modify your genes. You may not be able to choose your parents. You can only choose your in-laws and change them if you like. What is very important for you to do, along with the medications of the doctor, see to it that stress, lifestyle is managed. Be with the greens if you can. Be with water if you can. Be with loved ones if you can. As Dr. Shashank said beautifully, exercise, yoga, relaxation, and medications are very important. The entire body is like the clouds. Each one can affect the other. Each organ can destroy the other. So it's extremely important that we work in harmony with our minds and with the bodies so that we may not need an endocrinologist very often. And if we have to go, if one has to go, remember, those patients who go to the doctors regularly, even when they're all right, on their appointments, maintain their diabetes well and maintain their mental illness extremely well with few hospitalizations and few admissions. Lastly, we're going to come back again next week. Enjoy a Diwali with what Dr. Shashank said. Eat, taste a little, eat slowly. Look at the sweets, but remember to light a diya for yourself and for your family and for all those who have lost their lives and for all those who are still struggling in the hospitals as patients and as COVID warriors.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shetty. Quickly, just a few comments I'm going to read. Dr. Shetty, your background is fascinating today. Dr. Radhika Pandit says, excellent talk, Dr. Shetty. Dr. Shashank, very good observations about stress lifestyle. Chaya Sawant is saying, thank you for ABCDF criteria. And then we have, yes. Oh my God, so much information in so little time. I'll watch this video thrice so that I can imbibe the info provided. Doc, this is such a vital topic. Can't thank you enough. Dr. Joshi, last thought. Thank you.
So I think, continuing, I think diabetes is a very large ocean.
Yes.
And COVID is just a small river in this ocean, yes. If you ask me. And we know so much about diabetes. I'm going to, answer a question which my teacher of microbiology, Dr. Kaundinya, asked about mindfulness techniques.
Correct.
See, I think, what he has asked is very relevant today in lifestyle change. Okay. Nature and nurture, it can heal us. And if you are actually going to be, as Dr. Shetty also said, that if you are going to be de-stressed, you're going to be cool, you're going to be calm, you're going to be composed and correct, you won't get diabetes. But a lot of people generate negativity. They will say, we do perfect diet, perfect exercise. And despite of perfect diet and exercise, we don't have any stress. Still, we have got diabetes. Okay. So, sometimes it is genetic. Sometimes it is lifestyle. So, a lot of my patients tell me, doctor, you are very convenient. When you feel we are perfect on lifestyle, you say it is the genes. When you say that your genes are good, but your lifestyle is bad, you blame us on lifestyle. Remember, diabetes is a dual defect disease.
Right.
It has some component of genetics. It has some component of lifestyle. The only vaccine for diabetes today, a lot of people ask me a question, what is the vaccine for diabetes today? Vaccine for diabetes today is mindfulness. Vaccine for diabetes today is to ensure that you stay calm, because if your mind is calm, then you are able to take rational, appropriate and correct decisions of monitoring your glucose. And we can monitor it 24/7 now. We have these all AGP machines and all these CGM machines where we can monitor it. We also have now techniques. For example, I am now working with a reversal program called Twin Health, where we are actually, you can actually attach yourself to devices where we monitor your blood pressure 24/7, your heart rate 24/7, your glucose 24/7. We do all your parameters, and it's expensive. If you are interested, they actually find out which food is red, green and yellow. And if you are able to find that food which is causing the sugar to go up, then we avoid that food and we eliminate that food. And that way we can actually divide our own way of living with diabetes with a lot of positivity. In that, to go through that journey, you need to do mindfulness. Mindfulness by whatever method you may do, whatever meditation technique you may use, whatever, whether it is a Western technique or ancient Indian technique. And I think India is rich in traditions of diabetes. The world's center of diabetes, which is a Joslin Clinic in the United States, if you go there is actually a picture. And we didn't do slides today. Okay. We can actually see the picture where you can actually see that they have mentioned Charak and Sushrut Samhita, and the word Madhumeha is mentioned there. So remember that all the lifestyle techniques which are there in our ancient Hindu scriptures are also enshrined in the Western world. Similarly, it is just not the Charak and Sushrut Samhita, the Egyptian scriptures. See, the Egyptians and the Indians understood diabetes so many years back in the ancient era. But that time, lifestyle was not predominant. Lifestyle only has now come up in the last 50 years when you're seeing explosion of diabetes. Today in India, we have almost 80 million diabetics. But for every one diabetic, at least we know two diabetics don't know they have diabetes. And a large proportion of our country has also got pre-diabetes. So we need to generate a lot of positivity and we need to have a simple prevention mantra. Okay, and my prevention mantra for diabetes with a COVID mantra. So it has to be a diabetes COVID mantra. I call it as DC mantra during Diwali time. And that is eat slowly, eat on time, eat the right food. Okay. Do at least 10,000 steps a day. Do some Surya Namaskar, Uthak Baitak to build some good muscles. Ensure that walk the talk. Beyond that, sleep for at least 7 hours. Be smiling, do mindfulness. And beyond all this, if you have diabetes, monitor your glucose, see your doctor regularly, and simply follow A for A1C, B for blood pressure, C for LDL cholesterol below 50 or 70, or the heart checkup every year, D for diet, E for exercise, and exercise, mental exercise, as Dr. Shetty said, is as important as physical exercise, because there's no point doing a lot of physical activity all the time thinking or hearing something on your microphone. Listen to music. Music is healing. Music has positivity. Music has soothing abilities. And of course, check out your feet. We want to have a complications-free diabetes and a COVID-free world. And that's what my mission is and our mission is. And we all are here as team one. All of you all are ambassadors of diabetes across the world. On behalf of the International Diabetes Federation, I want to thank all of you all. And I thank Dr. Shetty also. And thank you, Anirudh, that you are a part of this mission. And each one of you all are the brand ambassadors for a change. We need to change the lives with diabetes. And we need to change the world without diabetes. And I think we can make it happen. If we are motivated, we can make it happen. I really admire all your commitments. And I wish all of you all a very, very happy Diwali. Have a green Diwali. Have a pollution-free Diwali. Have a COVID-free Diwali. Have a safe Diwali. And, you know, best wishes to everybody. And season's greetings.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thanks for joining. Have a happy Diwali. Thank you, Dr. Shetty. Thank you, Dr. Joshi.